may need to... What I wanted to do today was just really get straight into the presentation rather than discuss some maintenance type things. When we were down in Melbourne, one of the talks that we did down in Melbourne was a talk about love and the world's definition of love. So it was part of the human relationships, if you like, series of talks that I've been doing. And it's the world's definition of love. Now, you could call this what we're going to do today, session two, because I wanted to present, that's not how you spell session. Because I'd like to present some more information about the world's definition of love and compare that with God's definition of love. Now, one of the things I mentioned in the introduction to that talk was this, that the world... world thinks... Can anyone... Did any of you see the talk? That it knows... thinks it knows what love is. If you added up all the songs that have ever been sung, I'd say, and it's only a guess because I don't know for certain, but I'd say the majority of them are about love in some way, either broken hearts or, you know, love in some other way. And the world just has this viewpoint, doesn't it? That it knows exactly what love is. That everybody on the planet has this inbuilt tuner and we're all tuned into love. Unfortunately, that's not the case, but that's what we sometimes believe. The world also thinks it knows what love does. And unfortunately, if that was the case, you would think that there would be no war on this planet. You would think there'd be very little pain associated with love on the planet, and so forth. So the reality is quite different to what we all believe. It's interesting, I find, that all of us as individuals believe we know what love is, but the world is in a mess, in an unloving mess. Now, that doesn't make much sense to me. I don't know about you. But for each of us as an individual to basically say, well, I know what love is, it's all of you that don't know. And then the next person says, I know what love is, and it's all of you that don't know. And everyone in the world is basically saying that we all know what love is, but it's you guys that don't know. When the reality is the world is a reflection of the lack of love that obviously exists within our soul. Is there children out there? Because it's quite noisy, whatever that is. If we can just ask that noise to stop, that'll be good. We also have the world thinking that it knows what love feels like. Isn't that the case? Like if you have a nice warm sensation in there, then it must be love. Right? Come on, you guys. Isn't that the case? It must be love, love, love. And so we sort of think that certain feelings are associated with love. And yet the reality is, if we really analyse what's going on between ourselves and another person, many times it's just that our addiction just got met, rather than actually it being some kind of loving transaction where no addiction gets met. So oftentimes we think we know that love feels like, and oftentimes it's feeling like something just made us feel happier or made us feel more joyful and so forth. But if we get underneath it, we start seeing that actually there's some addictions in play. Yeah. So that's the general feeling that we often have. So that's what the world thinks. What do you think? Many of you have been listening now for a couple of years, yes? Many of you? And you've been listening to a lot of talks, and many of the talks are about love, yes? Now, how are you going practicing love in your own day-to-day life? Can you see, we can intellectually receive a lot of information about something, but practicing love in our day-to-day life is a lot more difficult than just hearing the words and trying to put those words into action, isn't it? And this is the problem we face. The problem we face is that for ourselves to be able to practice love, there needs to be a change inside of the heart that causes it to occur, doesn't there? There needs to be something that changes inside of us here that causes us to automatically be able to put love into practice rather than having to work at it constantly. And I feel what's been happening for many of you is that many of you have been trying to put love into practice without letting go of the underlying emotion that drives a different behavior. Do you understand? Yep. So what I would like to do is just talk for a moment about this with you before we start discussing more about what the world thinks about love. And I have said at some point I would do a talk about cause and effect at some point in the future. Today's not going to be it, by the way. But if we can just look at the issues of cause and effect for a little while. It's sort of like a cycle between the two of them. If there is an emotional cause inside of me that causes me to be unloving towards another person in a certain situation, then dealing with the effect of that is only going to be a temporary response, isn't it? Because the cause still remains within myself. So while I am here, sitting here in our auditorium, feeling a certain emotion towards you, that emotion now generates my speech, it generates my thoughts, and it generates my actions. Now, as it's doing that, I can choose to intellectually look at my thoughts, look at my speech, and look at my actions, and choose to change them in that moment from an intellectual perspective, can't I? Many of you are doing this in your day-to-day life because you have a feeling inside of you, I want to be more loving. So this feeling is there inside of you. And one of the ways that we then try, if I can just write that word down, it's an interesting word, try. I try then to put the principles of love that I think I've learned, but I've actually only got an intellectual database of inside of my brain. But I try to then put this intellectual knowledge into day-to-day practice. And as I try to put the knowledge into day-to-day practice, I find that certain events come up, because of course my soul will attract these events. Certain events come up, and as the events come up, what I do is I intellectually say, here's an area where I need to be careful, because last time I did this, last time I did that, and that wasn't very loving. So this time what I'm going to do is something different to that. I'm going to do this and I'm going to do that. So you go off and you try to do those things that you've intellectually decided you'll do. But the problem is, unless the unloving causal emotion, the actual reason why you would normally take a certain action, is released from within you, unfortunately you're going to be fighting your own nature, aren't you? And many of you are finding this. When you are trying to fight your own nature and trying to change the effect through an intellectual decision, do you know what path you're on? It's called the natural love path. All right. Now, many of us are still on the natural love path because we don't yet understand, even here in our heart, and some of us yet to even understand here in our head, that unless we deal with the emotional cause of unloving behavior, the effect is always going to be an unloving action, word or speech, unless my intellect kicks in and tells me not to do that and I try to do something different. And that's where many of us are at. Because we're yet to be prepared to address the emotion or the belief. Remember, emotions are beliefs. All beliefs are emotional. They all have some way of entering us into it as an emotion. And we're somehow not addressing the belief or the emotion that is inside of our heart that causes us to take that action. Now, perhaps if I give a few examples of this, right? So let's say the effect is every time I get with an older man, I always seem to attract him telling me what to do. Now, when I get with an older woman, she doesn't do that. But whenever I speak with an older man, he always does it without fail. And then inside of me, because he's telling me what to do, inside of me there's this feeling that comes up, you know, like, he's telling me what to do again. And all of a sudden we start feeling like, I don't like him very much, he always tells me what to do. So now there's the lack of love starting to boil up inside of our soul, inside of our feelings, right? Now, when we use our mind, what we do is this. We go, yeah, I can't tell him that though. I can't tell him that he's trying to control me because then he might be angry with me and I don't want him to be angry with me. Or what if I'm wrong? What if I tell him he's trying to control me and he just says, no, I'm not trying to control you. What do I do then? Then I'll look like I've got egg on my face and, you know, it'll be very uncomfortable emotionally if I, you know, feel a bit ashamed of myself. So I want to avoid my shame. So here I'm going. I'm starting to avoid emotions. I'm avoiding I'm avoiding shame, the potential for being ashamed or being shamed or humiliated. I'm avoiding the potential for the other person's anger or rage being projected at me. And so now, see how already my mind has already begun this process. This process of changing my own natural behavior, which would be harmonious with truth or love, into avoiding some of my own personal emotions. So what do I say to him? I go, oh yeah, no worries. Oh yeah, yep, yeah, I get that. Yeah, no worries. And all the while I'm thinking inside, gee, I'm sick of listening to this guy. He's always telling me what to do. Inside of me, I've got a completely different message going on than outside of me. Outside of me, he's just hearing the words, yes, I go, yes, yes. And I'm going, oh, when's the time? Inside of me, when's the time going to be? I just check the watch. There's this feeling inside of me, I just want to get away from this person. I don't want to be with him anymore. But outside, I'm going, yes, no worries, yes, no worries. Oh, my wife's just come. I've just got to go and speak with her. Like, now, what have I done? I have decided to be completely untruthful with that person. And of course, every time I'm untruthful, I'm also being unloving. I've decided to be untruthful by not portraying to them exactly what I am feeling. The reality is, if I was being truthful, what would I do? I'd just say, can you just stop for a moment? The feeling I have inside of me is annoyance. And I feel annoyed because it feels like you're telling me what to do again. And I'm tired of listening to that now. That would be more reflective, wouldn't it, of what's really inside of me. But because I'm afraid of potential shame or humiliation and potential anger from him or another emotion, and I'm afraid of how I'm going to cope with that, really, at the end of the day, I don't address the cause. Instead, I focus on dealing with the effect. I've got this man approaching me, and he's telling me what to do, and my way of handling it is to, you know, listen, yes, 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 and then try to get away from him as soon as possible, which is actually me being completely false. And if we have a mic, there's microphones, but with the mics, could you make sure you sort of hand, if this is the mic, if you put it about that distance from your chin and up a little, because then we will hear you very clearly. Can you do that? So if we can hand the mic back. Thanks, Steve.
My question is, well, in the case that the man truly is trying to control you, because I think that's still not a cause, really. I mean, there's a reason why the man's trying to control you, right?
No, what I'm saying is there's an emotional cause inside of your soul that opens you to the potential control of another male.
Right.
Yep.
So even saying you're annoyed, I mean, it's moving towards the cause, but it's not really addressing the full cause, is it?
I agree totally, but how can we move towards the cause while we're even denying
pretending
the truth?
Yeah. Okay.
We can't.
Yeah, I'm just wondering, because I've seen a lot of people make accusations that are so filtered by their own wounds.
I agree totally.
Yeah,
and that is not addressing the cause either. That's
right.
Just dealing with some other emotional effects, isn't it?
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep. Mary? She says she doesn't want to be up here, and then she has these feelings.
I promise to be quiet. I feel that's a very good point.
Yeah.
That has just been made by someone, because I feel that when we own our annoyance, we must own it, as in this is my feeling right now.
Yes.
This is because otherwise it's very easy to get into blaming, yep. And this my little bugbear speaking truth that is not actually speak. If I say you're just controlling me, I'm very far away from truth, because the truth is my feeling is I feel controlled.
However, I am a step towards truth than from total denial.
Exactly. Mm. And I have to go to that place before I'm going to discover God's truth about the situation.
Yep.
Because it may be in the end that you are controlling me, but while I'm having an emotional response, the first truth I need to consider is what is my feeling? Because
this is what I want to say to the group, is that we need to stop all of this intellectual stuff and just feel and correctly reflect the feeling.
Yes.
So the feeling, initial feeling is, he's being controlling. That's the initial feeling I have. Now, I'm nowhere near the truth of what's causing me to feel that at this point. It's just a feeling that I have inside of me. So he's being controlling. Now, if I allowed myself to feel that, but even better, say that and feel that without blaming the other person or without attacking them. See, this is where most of us go wrong, you see, isn't it? We initially go, you're being controlling. You know, and now we're attacking them and we're actually now projecting rage at them, which is actually worse than controlling. In terms of, if you had a scale of unloving behavior, rage is much lower in the condition of love than controlling is. Do you follow me? So the reality is that, you know, we're now not only saying the truth, what we feel is the truth, but we're now actually giving him a dose back, which is actually the unloving behaviour. But if we felt like he's being controlling and we just stopped and stated, I feel controlled. I feel in this discussion, I'm feeling controlled. I am at least one step further along the chain of truth and therefore one step closer to my true emotional condition than I am by not saying the words. Is that not the case? Now, I feel controlled, but he might not be controlling me. Is that not also true? So he might not be controlling me. I might just feel controlled because of something deeper inside of myself that I need to discover. But at least if I say the words, I feel controlled in this situation, and the reality is I also feel like running away from you, and the reality is I don't feel like having this conversation, and I actually said those words, right, rather than thinking them without saying them, if I actually said them, we would be one step closer to discovering the truth about the emotion than we would have been before then. But see, what most of us do is we feel the feeling, but we don't actually say anything. So from that point on, we're cut off from the process of discovering the cause. Can you see that? And if the cause remains within my heart without ever being discovered, it's now impossible for me to ever really change without trying. I have to try again to change, rather than change being a natural process. So, if we're finding, in terms of our own becoming more loving, that we're having to try to be more loving, then what I'm suggesting to you is that you're in the wrong process. The correct process would be that we remove the cause of why we're not more loving, and as soon as we remove the cause, the action will automatically change. It's cause and effect. The action is going to automatically change, and when the action automatically changes, I won't have to try anymore because it's a natural thing for me now to be more loving in that interaction. I don't have to try hard to be more loving. It just comes natural from my own actions and from my own words and from my own thoughts even. And in fact, I don't even have to notice my thoughts anymore. I don't have to notice and intellectualize my feelings anymore, and I don't have to actually watch what I say anymore, because everything coming out of my mouth and every action I'm taking is in harmony with the new condition, and the new condition is loving, and so therefore every word that comes out of my mouth will be loving, and every action I take will be loving. How much does that simplify your life? Sue, you...
Yeah, I could get really emotional even trying to talk about this, because, I mean, I've been listening to you for 2.5 years plus now, and I've worked out most of this for myself.
Yep.
And I've come to situations again and again, and I don't know how to talk to somebody, because by the time I understand that, I'm already really upset.
Yeah.
And so I already know that I'm projecting. My brain turns to marshmallow. I can't remember what to say.
Yep.
And I don't know how to hold the space and hold myself as an independent entity and have a conversation that remains loving.
Like, okay.
It happens with Raj again and again. And I know that I'm already upset, I'm already projecting, and I'm lost in the emotion.
Right. Well, what you're describing is a big emotion called fear. Right? And obviously, we need to feel our fears. So if you're finding, you go, blah, 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 I can't speak to you anymore because I have this feeling inside of me. Like, when I first met Mary, I was like that, right? And so I couldn't speak, you know, anything that came out of my mouth seemed to not make any sense whatsoever. And so I thought it was better to shut up. But you can still feel the fear of it inside of you and still access the emotion. Like, so the reality is, you don't have to even say the words if you're already in the emotion, but you certainly do need to say the words if you're thinking something and you're thinking of taking an action that is completely different to what you're actually feeling. So what I'm saying to you is, stay in the truth verbally and intellectually and emotionally of what you're feeling. Stay in the truth of that. If you stay in the truth of that, you will then be able to see how out of harmony you are. And that's great, because if you can see out of harmony you are, you can then address it emotionally by feeling the emotion that's underneath it. So I feel if you're feeling the fear, that's fine. Feel that fear.
Well, sometimes it's a whole spectrum of emotion. Sometimes, I mean, immediately after fear is usually anger and some form of defense.
But remember, fear is not after anger. Anger suppresses fear. So if I'm feeling this and then I revert to this, now I am definitely denying the truth of what's going on inside of me. Okay. Do you follow me? Anger is not after fear. Anger is the suppression of fear, or the suppression of the addiction that keeps the fear under control. Right?
I understand you intellectually. I just can't work out how to do it in practice.
Right.
And I seem to have a capacity to project. It's like a million miles an hour, and yes. Everybody's upset and offended, and then I haven't got a clue what the hell to do.
Yep, I agree. However, what I'm suggesting to you is to learn to just speak the truth of how you feel at any one moment. But reverting to anger is always telling you that you're covering over an addiction. And it has to be a pretty big addiction if you're always going to back to the same behaviour. Yeah. So pray about the addiction. Pray about feeling the addiction.
Okay.
Yeah, that's all you need to do. I feel a lot of us are intellectualising this process far too much. Instead of, like, to me it's pretty basic. You tell the truth of everything you think at every moment if you're able to, in terms of the situation enables you to. I'm not saying if the people enable you to. I mean if the situation does. So if you see something happening 500 metres over there and you're having a feeling, it's going to be pretty hard to say the truth to that person over there 500 metres away. The physical situation disallows it. However, you can certainly say the truth to the person next door. Wow, I just saw that thing over there and, yeah, he's a bastard. That's how I feel. Now, that's covering over deeper emotion. But if I go, oh, did you see that happening over there? I wonder why he did that. I wonder what's going on for him. I wonder what kind of things he's going through his mind. And all the time, inside of me, I'm going, he's a bastard. Now I'm way away from truth. Right? And we need to learn to be in the truth of what we're feeling to get anywhere. We need to see it as it really is. If we come across to here, where's the second mic? Oh, Tris, thank you.
Oh, that's really loud. I've found
you don't like hearing yourself, Ivana.
No, I don't actually.
Okay. It's a bit hard to be a
even
good
singer. Even when I'm
you want to sing, don't you?
Yeah.
It's going to be a hard emotion, that one, isn't it?
Well, last night I was singing at a restaurant and I didn't really like hearing. Yeah,
your own
I've got
voice.
A lot of judgments about my voice. Mm. Something I was going to say was I found myself doing this at work, like. But it's like just with the other people that I work with, the staff. But I'm feeling how much I'm just hooking into, I'm just realising how actually unloving I am, like, by doing that.
Yep.
And it's like I'm bitching all the time.
Yep.
And, me and Justin have started to be more honest about things as well and, like, more honest about our judgments towards other people.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't know really where I was going with that. But I felt like your example there was like an example of what's going on for me in my life,
yeah.
Like at work.
Yeah.
I
feel many in the audience are doing this on a daily basis.
Yeah.
Like trying to intellectualise themselves through a process that the heart hasn't changed through yet. And when you try to do that, you're not actually being honest about what's really in your heart. Like, to really change, you need to have a very good look at the mirror of the emotions. Like, so, many of you check yourself out in the mirror every day, don't you? Or you try not to nowadays. What is it? So, what you do is you check yourself out in the mirror, and usually it's for correction, isn't it? Like, you go, oh yeah, there's a big, cocky crest, no, there, better wet that one down, and so forth. You check things out so that at least, you look relatively presentable, right? And we don't do this in the same manner with our soul. What we do is we have these things running through our emotional state, like things where, oh, I don't like her, I don't like him, oh yeah, he's all right because he gave me something. You know, we have all these things going on inside of us, but we're not really honest about what's driving every one of them. And this is where when we can learn to say what we feel, then we're at least being a step closer to the state of true honesty and therefore a step closer to love.
Yeah. Something I have noticed though is how I'm taking that next step of being more honest,
mm-hmm.
but then realising how much I really don't actually want to change.
Yes.
I want to stay.
And
I
we need to
stay.
Be honest about that too.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, I agree. Yeah. So did you all get that, like, admitting, I don't want to be more loving. I just want to be angry. I just want to be upset. I just, you know, like, allowing yourself to feel that you just want to be whatever it is that you're in is a much more honest place than maintaining a facade but feeling all of that anyway. It's a much more honest place. It's not a much more loving place. It's only a slightly more loving place, obviously, but it is a much more honest place. Yeah, yeah. Could we go up the back to Jen? That's fine.
Thank you, Yeshua. I find I'm very sensitive now, and my own feelings get mixed up with what's coming at me, what I'm sending out, and I hit a pocket of pain. Is the pain the same as the causal?
Not always, Jen, but you're heading in the right direction if you're allowing yourself to feel your own pain rather than push that pain onto others. But it might not be the causal. You see, the reality is the world's beliefs or definitions about love have rubbed off on us. So therefore, a lot of our beliefs of what love would do are actually false. And so you see, we often believe love would do a certain thing, and then we feel pain that that's not happening, when the reality is our belief was false in the first place. So just because we feel pain, it doesn't mean all of a sudden that we're going to find a causal emotion, but we are at least closer to finding the cause of what's going on within us, at least. If we're projecting our pain by harming or trying to harm or trying to shut down or trying to control or trying to be more angry with someone around us, now we are nowhere near even the cause. We're not even at the point of feeling our own pain, let alone understanding what its cause is. You could say the effect is the pain that we feel, and the cause is usually deeper than that.
So I find when I reach the pain, I freeze up.
Yep. So
I'm kind of oscillating between this terrified and I'm overwhelmed, but I hit the pocket of pain, mm-hmm. and I seem to kind of go around in a circle, and yep. then I shut it all down.
And I feel many are doing that. What's happening is they hit their fear and they don't want to bodily experience their fear or their terror. Many of you are in this place where you hit your terror or your fear, but you don't want to actually feel that emotion, because it's one of the worst emotions you could actually feel. In fact, I would place the feeling of terror. So if we look at the terror, if you can learn how to feel your terror, there is little other emotions that you're going to have trouble with. But it's your terror that is the most difficult emotion for you to experience. So if you can learn to feel your terror without getting out of it, you will have accomplished a great deal in your work towards being more loving. You see, every time we normally get terrified, what we do is we shut down the feeling of terror within us, and then as a result, we are now in the rage or angry place, shutting down the terror, and we want everyone around us to do the same for me as what I've just done for myself. We want other people to stop triggering our terror. Right? So many of us finish up projecting at our husbands or our wives. How dare you do that? You shouldn't have done that. And really underneath of that is we're just terrified of something, but we don't want to admit that. And we don't, more importantly, want to feel it. So what we do is we get out of that terror by going in, because terror feels very weak for the majority of us, yes? It feels, in fact, one of the most vulnerable places we could ever go emotionally is terror. And in fact, the society has a lot of judgments about terror too, by the way. You know, you look at the average Vietnam vet who comes back from Vietnam, he's in a state of post-traumatic stress, And yet society doesn't allow him to go through that post-traumatic stress as an emotion. And so instead society gives him some medication, pumps him full of, and usually he himself might go finish up drinking or whatever, just to stay away from the terror that he felt by going to war and in that environment. Right? Now, people view terror as weak. The physical expression of terror is something that most people feel very, very afraid of even being around, let alone experiencing it themselves. So as a result of that, they have a lot of judgments of terror. And then, of course, where do you go? If you can't feel your terror, what are you going to do? You're just going to get angry. You're going to get into a state where anger becomes a dominant emotion. So we need to allow the terror to be felt, not to intellectualize it. Many of us still try the intellectual process. Ah, yes, I can see that the reason why I got angry was because I was really afraid because that person reminded me of my mother who used to come along with a big stick and belt me, right? Now, that's a lovely intellectual analysis of what might be the underlying emotional reason why you got angry. However, it just did nothing for you, because it never got you into feeling the terror that you felt when your mother came to with a stick to smack you. It never got you to that feeling. And many of us have these feelings. The reality is, within society, and particularly within most Christian societies, which ours was, you know, 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago, more so than now, and the reality is in many religious societies, parental violence towards children is an acceptable way of discipline, is it not? So, you know, I remember with my own sons, you know, sometimes get a stick or a strap, and if they did the wrong thing, give them a whack, and that was their punishment. And the justification of it was, well, the Bible says if you spare the rod, you spoil the child. So I've got to do this even though I might not want to, as many times I think, the feeling. Now, as a child, a little child, how does a little child feel about that? Now, they've got an adult with an angry look on their face, with a weapon, beating them, many times not just smacking them once, but beating them in their rage. How is that going to... That isn't the result of that going to be this emotion? Terror? Yeah? Isn't that the case? I want to say a bit more before I ask some more. So if that's the case, if this terror is now the emotion that the child is now has, what can the child now do with that? Now that we're an adult, we can see that all of us pretty much, if we've had that kind of an upbringing, at some point we're going to have to deal with terror. At some point, we're going to have to physically feel the emotion of terror. And we're not going to get to darker emotions within, you know, like grieving emotions within us, without experiencing getting through our terrors at some point. So we need to embrace the feeling of terror and allow ourselves to bodily feel that feeling when it comes up. And so if we have an event that our soul attracts, that cause through the law of attraction that comes up, that triggers this terror, we are better off going into the terror and experiencing the terror than we are coming into some kind of intellectual analysis of what just happened. Because as soon as we go into the intellectual analysis of what happened, we are now avoiding the terror through the intellect, which is never going to heal the terror. The terror is going to remain within us, and therefore the terror will become a cause of many events in our lives, one after the other. Once the terror is gone as a cause, now it cannot generate any effects. I don't have to try now to avoid situations that might terrify me, because the reality is no situation terrifies me anymore. That all makes sense, intellectually at least. But it's the feeling of the emotion of terror. As soon as I'm presented with that through a situation, I then go into a state where I detune from the situation, skip out of my body, step away from the situation, try to intellectualize myself over the situation, try to avoid the situation. I do hundreds of different things just to avoid the feeling. of terror. Now, the world, one of the world's definition of love is that love helps you not feel emotions like that. Is that not the case? There's this belief in the world that if I love you, I would never, if you were in an emotion of terror, I would never say go for it. I'd go, oh, you know, I'd hold you, calm you down, make you feel safe, make you feel secure, make you feel like you'd never have to feel that emotion again. But there's a problem with that, and that is, if I don't feel the emotion remains within me, and so I am going to feel that emotion again, guaranteed. And this is the problem with that kind of belief system. Now, you guys had some questions about terror? Yep, so let's...
Terror is a really big one for me, and I do experience, you know, like emotions in my or sensations in my body. Where I feel I'm getting confused is Mary's referred to living in the terror rather than dealing with it. So are there some distinctions there that can be made?
Sure. Living in the terror means that the terror now defines your actions. So in other words, let's say somebody said, Nina, it's time for you to learn how to be in front of an audience. So what we're going to do is get you to come up here right now and talk for 5 minutes on a subject, right? Now, Nina's terror level just went from there to there, right? So what happens now? Now, Nina, in that state, can choose to avoid that feeling of terror, and what would she do?
Not get up and talk.
Exactly. So you are now living in the terror. In other words, the terror has defined your next course of actions. That's when you're living in the terror. Or you could choose to get up and stand here dumb for 5 minutes because you can't just open your mouth because you're so terrified and feel that emotion, couldn't you? And if the audience is accepting, they'd possibly accept that, depending on how accepting the audience is, that'd allow you to go through that particular emotion. And if they don't, then that would even increase your terror a bit more, and so you've got more to feel now, terror and humiliation at the same time. Wonderful. So you can feel that too. And so your terror, if you do that, is no longer defining your actions. In other words, you're taking actions that are more loving, even though the terror was pushing you in a different direction. Now, if terror defines your actions, then you are living in your terror and you are not releasing it. Right? Same goes with fear, same goes with shame, same goes with any other emotion. If it defines your action, and in particular causes you to take an action that's unloving, then obviously now you're living in it. Now this happens all the time for many of us. Like you've heard of claustrophobia, yes? Just a basic fear of confined spaces, isn't it? So what does a person with claustrophobia normally do? They avoid confined spaces. Now they get to not experience the terror that is within them, but you put them in a confined space, and ironically, their law of attraction, God's law of attraction, from their own soul in operation, their own soul's injuries in operation, will actually attract an event that finishes up with them in a very confined space, like a sardine can space, and now there's all sorts of emotions that need to arise, and it depends on what they do as to what will happen next. Right? Now, many of them will live in their action of terror, and they will scream, yell, run, you know, they'll do all sorts of things without actually feeling the terror itself. So same goes with fear, same goes with shame, same goes with all these other emotions. Now, what Mary was referring to is that we need to stop living in it. In other words, stop letting the emotion dictate the next action and instead just feel the emotion. Now, many of us are not doing that either, unfortunately. What we're doing is we're stopping our terror from dictating our action, but then what we do, we use this intellectual gymnastics that we have, and I'm sorry, but I can't do many gymnastics nowadays, and we do this intellectual flip over, and before we know it, we've got ourselves even away from the feeling of terror by using our intellect to explain away why we feel terrified without actually feeling it. And we do this quite frequently. Now, if we do that, the terror is the cause of many of our attractions. Much of our soul, if our soul is full of terror, it is attracting on a day by day, often on an hour by hour basis, all these different events, right? And so it's the cause of many events which we then try to avoid. So what happens in our life? The terror, through dictating our actions, creates a prison that we now live in of our own construction because we do not want to feel the emotion. Right? And that's living in the emotion rather than experiencing it and releasing it. And that's not what we're recommending to do. However, that is what many of us are doing. Right? Many of us are doing that. Yep. If we took a different tack and we chose to fully experience this terror and release all judgments that we have about it, and by the way, the world has a lot of judgments about terror. If we chose to release all the judgments we have in the process, then we have the actual ability to completely erase from within our soul the feeling of terror. You imagine that? That will no longer define any action that you take. Now that is a sense of freedom, isn't it? That will result from that. There will be complete freedom that results from that. And this is where we can try to be free, but while we're carrying around terror in our soul, we can never be free. We can try to live an unashamed life, but while we're carrying around shame within our soul, we will always have something that occurs that causes us to feel shame. That's the reality. It's the reality with every emotion we face. Right. Now, the world thinks that it's loving to just deal with the effects. That is the state of the world, even in its thinking. And what I'm explaining to you is that, no, we need to understand that unless we're willing to deal with the cause, we're not even loving ourselves, let alone loving anything else. Because it's the cause that can be released from us that now can cause us to be completely loving once those things are released. So you imagine, if you can just imagine for a moment, if you had a life where terror or fear no longer motivated any of your choices or decisions. Now, your life would be rapidly changing, would it not? Things would be happening very quickly in your life. Things would be changing very rapidly. You would be attracting different events into your life as a result of living in your passions and your desires more. Things would happen so rapidly that you'll be going, with your head spinning, going, wow, life's pretty interesting. I'm not even planning my life and it's pretty interesting. You know, like that's what would be happening inside of you. Yeah. But as soon as the terror takes now the role of defining my actions, what's going on now? What's going on now? I have no chance of ever being free. I have no chance of ever getting to what is underneath terror, which is usually a lot of grief underneath terror. And I have no chance of getting there. And in fact, there's a high likelihood I will revert to anger or rage in a situation as well, because I'm trying to shut down the cause of the anger or the rage, which is always the terror and the fear. Mm. Lorleen?
It's a bit, yeah. There's been a murder in my daughter's school.
Yep.
And the paper wrote and said this mother who stabbed her daughter and then jumped off the bridge was not a demon, and said that she was a loving mother. It's affected me quite a lot.
So her mother stabbed her daughter to death.
Yes.
And then jumped off a bridge in suicide.
Yes.
And the paper said
that she's not a demon.
That she wasn't a bad person.
Yeah, and she's a caring mother and she's a loving mother and all of these things that the world thinks what love is and all
right.
of that.
Right, yeah. And is this behaviour, this behaviour was sort of different to her normal behaviour. Obviously, she didn't have a string of daughters to kill, but...
Apparently she's quite highly strung as a woman.
Right, so she had a history of being emotional, shall we say.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay.
It's affected me, and what it's come to is sort of like a realization, like a terror that I've been really angry with my daughter.
Yep.
And what does it take to do this? And I've been feeling my mother's rage, my own rage at her.
Mm-hmm.
It's really quite dark.
Mm-hmm.
It's quite murderously angry.
Mm-hmm.
So I can't see really a difference between me and this woman.
Yeah. Aside from the fact that you haven't taken the action.
No.
Yep.
And I would hope I wouldn't, but then if I'm the same, the terror is, and I've been to terror quite often, I keep getting to it and I just can't get there. But I get closer.
Yep. But the terror is you're going to do that.
Well...
The potential is there.
Yeah.
Okay. And the question is?
How do I... if I keep trying to get to this terror, because it's really big in me...
Yep.
I haven't got there. I just keep getting closer.
Yep.
How do I get to...
How do you get to your terror without reverting to this kind of behaviour? Is that
yes? Because even though I might not do this, I project something out all the time because I'm in this terror.
Yeah. Okay. Can I answer it, Lorraine? If we understand the dynamic of what's going on with terror for many of us, and this is something that's very important to understand, is that the terror, as I just mentioned earlier, is usually covered over by addictions to help soothe the terror. And then when those addictions are not met, then the rage, if it's terror, it's always rage. If it's fear, it's always anger. Do you see the difference in scale? Terror, rage, fear, anger. Right? So the reality is if I have terror, there's going to be a rage in me once I deal with my addiction. So my addiction might be my children always do say and feel everything I tell them to. That might be my addiction. And while my addiction is being met, that my children do say and feel everything I say they should, now I will have no rage. But as soon as one of my children get into this state where they fight me, oppose me or whatever, now my addiction is not being met, which covers my terror, and now there is only one of two directions I can go. One direction is into my rage and the other direction is into my terror. Now what I'm going to suggest to you is that if you always choose to take the direction of your terror, you will never get into rage. And so therefore you could never do what this lady has done in her rage. Does that make sense to you? And by the way, yes, there probably were spirits interfering with her and causing her to stay in this rage to such a point that she's ready to murder her own daughter. And some spirits would have enjoyed her doing that, right? But the reality is if I'm willing to feel my addictions and go into my terror, even the spirit influence can no longer occur. However, when we go in this direction, there are many spirits around us telling us some messages that are untrue. One of those messages is, you can't feel your terror. That's one of the messages that many of you get told. You can't feel your terror. There's no way for you to actually release terror. So some of us get to our terror, but then we have all these feelings from spirits going, no, you can't do this. You're not going to get through this. It's going to be too big. God's not going to help you get through this. You're all alone with this, and you're going to do some damaging things if you let yourself do this. And by the time you've felt somebody yelling in your ear all of those things, you're already in a rage because they've just heightened your terror and put you back into the avoidance of your terror, unfortunately. If you allow yourself to stay in the terror and you stop having this feeling, and this is a feeling that we do need to address, it's the feeling that we are unable to release an emotion that's entered us. Now, logically, this cannot be true. If the emotion has logically entered us, then surely it has just the same ability to exit us. Does that make sense? Surely. It can't enter us and then never be able to be released. That does not make any logical sense. And then if we add God to the equation, which oftentimes when we're in terror we don't, but the reality is that God is in the equation if we embrace that process with God, the reality is we can feel this terror without doing anything damaging, either to ourselves or to another person. So we don't even have to worry. Now, many times spirits will come to you and they'll go, if you do this, you know, you're going to kill your daughter, or, you know, put that thought back into your mind because of something you saw on telly or so forth. The reality is it's just spirits having a play with you. Stay in the terror till it's released. Don't live in it, but stay in it. Like, feel the emotion in your body. Don't revert back to getting the addiction met or into the rage. That's all you need to do. The only time that somebody can induce you or help you go and murder somebody is when you are prepared to avoid this emotion and therefore go take the opposite direction. That's the only time that somebody can damage you. If you're prepared to feel this emotion, then you will never get to this emotion. That's the reality. Now, some of us do have childhood rage, but let's face it, most of our rage doesn't feel like a child. It feels like an adult in its power trip trying to do something. And that's what I'm referring to here. It's the same principle with fear and anger. It's exactly the same principle. In between fear and anger is an addiction that when it doesn't get met, we either have a choice to go to our fear or to our anger. Most of us still choose our anger. And why? Because we don't want to feel our fear. We don't want to. So we need to choose in a different direction. Now, most of the time we don't want to feel fear and terror because of our beliefs about such emotions. Our beliefs about such emotions are very dark beliefs. We actually believe we're not going to survive them. There's no way you can't survive an emotion. An emotion is within your soul. You're already surviving it. It's there inside of you already. You're surviving it already. Coming out of you is going to get better, not worse. Does that make sense? It's going to get better. Lorleen?
When I get to the terror, I hop out of my body.
Yes.
This happens quite regularly.
Yes.
It takes quite an effort to stay in.
Yes.
I just want to know how to take the next step of...
Stay in your body, pray to God that you want to stay in your body and feel the terror instead.
So what's happening then is that I'm actually lying, aren't I? Because I'm not doing it. Though I think I'm praying and I'm trying to stay in my body and I'm praying, that means I'm actually lying because I'm not going to the
terror. Yeah, don't be hard on yourself. There's no need to be hard on yourself. You obviously have a very strong reason for leaving your body.
Yes.
So accept that.
So then just keep praying.
Yes, but also accept that, discover the reason. I'm saying, discover the reason. The only way you're going to discover any reason for doing anything is by accepting that you do it and discovering the reason why. So allow yourself to feel like you want to get out of your body and let yourself feel why. Let yourself feel it. Why do I want to get out of my body now? Why? And there will be the reason why you keep jumping out of your body, basically, or, you know, stepping away from yourself. Just allow yourself to feel it. The answer is, in every single situation, allow yourself to feel the emotion that's present, not the one you're trying to access. You see, many of us are doing that. We're going, oh, I've got some grief about my mum and how she treated me. So here's my grief. And what's under my grief? What's above my grief? Oh, of course, I've got some fears associated with my grief. And what's over my fears? My addictions are over my fears. And what's above my addictions? My anger or my rage. And what's above my anger? Denial, yeah, intellectual processing, denial, depression, all of those kind of things. So that's way, way up there. So at any one point in time, all I need do is feel the emotion that's present. So for example, if I'm angry, I know that I'm not feeling the addiction. I could choose to feel the addiction instead and not be angry. So how do you feel an addiction? You sit there and you go, if you were a smoker, how would you feel the addiction? What would you do? You'd sit the cigarette packet on the table in front of you, sit down maybe, feel this feeling coming, and you allow your body to do its thing. Many of you, if you were a smoker giving up smoking, looking at a cigarette pack in front of you, what would you feel? Many of you have done this, so you know what to feel. And you can feel the emotion. Let yourself feel the emotion without taking the action. Let yourself feel the addiction. Wow, I need these cigarettes so much that it feels like my life depends upon it. That's how big this addiction is. It feels like I'm prepared to yell at my wife, kick the dog, just because I haven't had my cigarette today. That's what it feels like. Let yourself feel it without acting upon it. Feel it. Now you're feeling the addiction. You are one step closer to feeling the fear that the addiction covers now. Right? And I'm not saying intellectualize the addiction. I'm saying feel it. There's a big difference between thinking about the addiction and talking to everybody about the addiction than there is feeling it. Right? If you feel it, you can now feel through the addiction. You can feel the addiction and how powerful it is and how it's affecting your life, and all of these other things will start coming up for you. And then in this process, the underlying fear will eventually get to your consciousness. You will become conscious of the underlying fear-based reason why the cigarette is so important to you. That's what with a physical addiction. You can do exactly the same with every emotional addiction. You can feel it in exactly the same way, and then you'll get down through. So the process is allowing yourself to understand that if I'm in anger, this is why I've talked to you about these things in the past, if I'm in anger, then my addictions are, I'm choosing to not feel them. That's why I'm angry. I'm choosing to not feel my addictions. And if I'm in my addictions, I'm choosing to not feel my fear. That's the reality. So wherever you are, if you can acknowledge where you are, you can at least feel that level of emotion that's underneath that you're denying. Feel it rather than thinking it. If you don't feel it, you're not addressing with the cause, you're addressing the effect, you're trying, you're going into the intellect, and none of that is going to work. It's just going to drive you balmy. It's going to drive you nuts doing that. You know, many spirits on the process in the spirit world, going from the first dimension to the sixth dimension, have to do this intellectual process of trying, because they haven't discovered this other process, right? They do this intellectual process of trying. And you can talk to them 200 years later, and many of them still feel like they're still very close to what they were 200 years ago. That's how long it takes to try. Because you try, you might release a little bit of emotion. You try, you might release a little bit more. Try, release a little bit more. And you get this gradual release of different emotions that occurs as a result of trying. But you could just embrace the emotion and feel it completely, and it'll all be over for many of the spirits, all be over within the equivalent of, not at all, but one addiction be over within a day. And yet many of them are still on with the same addiction 100 years later, because they don't want to embrace the cause. They want to deal with the effect with their mind. Many of us have yet to embrace the emotional cause, and instead we want to deal with the effect in our mind. And this is why we keep doing the same thing. Okay, so I wonder how many of us in the room are on the Divine Love Path. So maybe we should stop bragging about being on the Divine Love Path and just get on with it, don't you think? Barbara, if we just have a mic. Sue's coming your way.
AJ, sometimes in my life, well, there's a particular occasion in my life where my body experienced terror. And that terror was things were happening to me where my body, in response to it, I couldn't move it. Yep. Like, you know when you said before that the world associates with terror weakness? My body was totally weak. I couldn't move. I had to physically lift up my leg with my arm, or lift up my arm with my other arm to physically get out of the situation.
Mm-hmm.
What's happening there, though? I'm not...
You're feeling terror. You see how much you want to get away from that feeling. It feels terrible, doesn't it?
Oh, shocking.
Yeah, and you want to get away from it. And I'm saying stay in it. You see, the response to terror generally is freeze. If you ever... my father, when I was young, used to go out shooting rabbits. And what they used to do, instead of shooting the rabbit, because they didn't want a mark on the rabbit when they took the rabbit to market, what they would do is they'd shoot over the top of the rabbit's head. And the sound barrier of the bullet passing so close to the rabbit would cause the rabbit to just go into freeze, into terror. And you could walk up and pick up the rabbit, and then he'd break its neck. Right? And that way the pelt had no marks on it and the body had no bullet hole in it. Now that is also the same response humans have to terror. We go into a frozen place generally, or a very close to frozen place. The key is to allow its experience. But see, most of us are very terrified of that place. Right? And we don't allow the experience of it. Instead, what we try to do is lift up our arm, lift up our leg, do something at least to make us feel like we have some control now over that place. Now we're out of the emotion. Do you see? So this is the thing with terror. Fear, what's fear responses? You know them. It's fight or
flight.
So when we're in fear, but we're not quite terrified just yet, we will either try to leave or fight. Fight is getting angry, is it not? And flight is running away. How many times do we do this emotionally? Now, I'm suggesting to you those responses are not the experience of fear, but rather the avoidance of the fear. They are the response. Terror, the feeling you have will be to freeze. And what actually happens when you allow yourself to fully experience the terror and go right into it, your body starts sort of twitching by itself and all of these frozen places in your body start unlocking. The ones that had frozen up this fear into this frozen place start actually coming apart. And you start twitching and rolling around and wriggling and all those kind of things starts happening inside your body as you're experiencing it. Now that looks pretty bad too. So most people don't like doing that either. But we need to allow ourselves to do it. The frozen place is the beginning, if you like, of that place, opening up into this place where your body starts unlocking its frozen state. The frozen state is the frozen emotion of terror within you.
So the situation that was occurring for me at the time that put me into that state, mm-hmm. I've often wondered, intellectually but I've wondered whether something else happened in my life previously for that to trigger that so instantly.
Highly likely.
Yeah.
Highly likely. Okay. Highly likely. Often our pathways into emotions, remember the law of attraction will bring you, God's law of attraction, because of the soul having terror within it, operating with God's law of attraction will bring an event to it to actually open it up to that particular feeling that's within the soul. So these events will happen. If you allow them to happen, you can rapidly get into the emotion. And then if you can stay in it, that's the secret. It's to stay in the frozen state and allow yourself to feel like you can't move, that you can't move any, and then breathe and just allow yourself to fully feel it. And after you go into it, your body will start twitching, moving, and releasing itself.
The problem I had there was that I had a person in my room with a knife for three months every night. And so I felt I had to get my body out of that to protect myself.
Yeah, it's an interesting...
I wasn't able to really
It's interesting that it took a person in your room with a knife, and I won't ask the personal situation or event, but to be in the room before you could feel that kind of terror.
Yeah.
Which the best way to do now is just to go into your own room by yourself and place yourself in your imagination back into that event and then allow your body to go and do its thing. Yeah. Or go and get some body work done where the person helps you get placed in back into that event and allow your body to do its thing. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you.
No worries. Okay. So what the point of all that was is that we often view ourselves as being loving when we help a person get out of the effect of what's been done, rather than helping a person get into the cause of what's going on for them. Right? And you know, in the course of a day where we have a seminar like this, in the course of one day of a seminar like this, myself and Mary often hear many of you getting somebody else out of their stuff. We overhear a conversation, there's another person getting that person out of their stuff. There's another person getting that person out of their stuff. And it's because we have this belief about love that's so in error. This belief that it's loving to help a person get out of their painful stuff. Now, when somebody does that with me, I find it quite frustrating still. The reason why is because I've just spent months trying to get into this stuff. And now you're trying to get me out of it? Like, you've got to be joking. So the reality for many of us is that we need to stop getting people out of stuff that they have spent weeks or months trying, their soul has been trying to access for that period of time. Now, for many of us, we have emotional trauma that far exceeds our current assessment of what we believe we can cope with. So if you could think of it like a line like this, where that's the zero point, if you like, of emotional trauma, and I'll just rub out this. So that's no emotional trauma. And then on the vertical, obviously, is the emotional trauma. Right? Many of us have in our lives, I'll put in red, this amount of emotional trauma. Now, most of it happened, unfortunately, in our childhoods, because that's the time when we were probably the most violently treated. You see, it's much harder to violently treat an adult than it is to violently treat a child. Now, this is proven by law, actually. For example, what I mean by that is that by law, if you hit somebody who's an adult, and you're an adult, what is that called? That's called assault. Right? And in fact, you can be put in jail for assault. That's the reality today. That's called assault. But when a parent gets a stick and beats a child for disobedience, what's that called? Discipline. What? Yeah, love, unfortunately. It's also called love, yeah. So the parent beats the child, and this word assault is now not used at all, and instead we call it loving discipline. Now, it's interesting, isn't it, that our definition changes when we reach an adult. When you reach an adult, somebody else hits you with a stick, or, in fact, with a stick, it's usually worse because there's a weapon involved. That's what it's called. It's called assault. But when it happens to a child, it's called a loving discipline. Well, we've got a lot to learn, haven't we? Don't you think? As a human race, about the true causes of emotional trauma. However, this assault that happened to many of you when you were young quite frequently, in fact, for many of you, it happened every single time you displeased your mother or father. For many of you, that's what occurred, wasn't it? Of course, you very rapidly learnt that if you want to avoid the pain on the backside or any other place where they assaulted you, you had to do what they said. And then after that, no assault occurred. So that was now a smooth life. And after that point in time, we go, yeah, I wasn't smacked very much at all, just a few times. Yeah, if somebody come along and punched you in the nose just a few times, how would you feel about that now as an adult? It's interesting, isn't it? How our concept of something changes based on what we're told or what the world judges or defines as correct. Anyway, we have this assault. I'm going to call it assault. By the way, I've been a perpetrator of assault of my own sons, so I'm not judging any of you for performing assault on your children or having your parents perform assault on you. However, I am saying that it is certainly not loving discipline, and it's certainly a violent act that causes terror and trauma. On the child, right? So we have that level of terror and trauma inside of us. Many of us have this, right? Now, much of this terror and trauma also comes from the potential threat of violence, not just from violence. So imagine if you're around a person constantly, every single day, who's about to explode. You'd be on tenterhooks after a while, wouldn't you? You'd be watching there, no, I can't do that. And your own actions and behaviour would change quite rapidly if you knew the person might go into this terrible rage at some point. And so after a while, you become adept at preventing their rage through your own fear of the potential result. So we can even have terror as a result of the threat of violence, not just as a result of violence itself. So, for example, we could have one act of violence and then just the threat of it thereafter, and now we are terrified every time it's even threatened because we've already had the painful violence in the first place and we're terrified every time thereafter. So we have that amount of terror and trauma with us. However, inside of us we also have, unfortunately, this belief that we can only cope with this amount of terror and trauma. We call that the terror and trauma coping level. Can you see straight away that it doesn't make much sense? Because if I've already received that amount of terror and trauma, it's obvious that I'm still alive, so therefore I have coped with it. So the reality is I can cope with that amount, not this amount. But we have beliefs that we can only cope with this amount. Right? Because the process of feeling terror and trauma is it's not only unattractive in terms of looking at it in somebody else, but also inside of ourselves, it feels so out of control. And we love control. Right? And so we feel we can only cope with that much. Now, the problem with only being able to cope with that much is that we're going to need something that causes us to be able to encompass the distance between these two points, right? The distance between what we feel we can cope with and what we actually have coped with. We need to be able to somehow close the distance. And this is where faith in God, faith in our own soul's ability, that God has created our soul with this ability to be able to handle so much, these kind of faiths are what we need. We need also the quality of courage. Courage is when you feel like you can't go any further, and you do. Right? And we need this quality of courage inside of ourselves if we're going to face the difference between the terror and trauma that we've actually experienced and the terror and trauma that we feel we can handle or cope with. Now, if we can do that and have those two qualities, then this terror will no longer define our viewpoint of love anymore. You see? At the moment, for many of us, it's defining our viewpoint of love still. We view love as a less powerful emotion than terror. We view love as weaker than anger. And we've got it all back to front, or Australian colloquialism, arse about, right, haven't we? We've got it all back to front. And the reason why we've got it all back to front is because we have placed many emotions above love as the most powerful emotion. From God's perspective, love is the most powerful emotion, and terror or fear is way down here in terms of powerful emotions. And in between there are the things like faith, courage, desire, all more powerful than fear. And yet what do? We do this. We say, no, don't believe that. Love is not the most powerful emotion. Terror is the most powerful emotion. And underneath terror is fear. And then underneath fear, in terms of powerful emotions, is anger, rage. These are the world's judgments of what are powerful emotions. They are the least powerful emotions from God's perspective. And it's very interesting when you arrive in the spirit world, because all of the people who have those emotions are in the darkest condition with the least amount of power. And literally millions of them have to band together to do anything. I was speaking to a group of spirits just a week or so ago when we were down at Quiabra, down in Kentucky in New South Wales. And there were 4 or 5 million of them that I was speaking to. And they were trying to tell me that they were one of the most powerful groups of spirits on earth. And the reason why they were, and we'll put this on the net at some point, this channeling, the reason why they felt that was because they had control of the Chinese government. And they felt the Chinese government was becoming one of the most powerful governments on earth. Right? And so we were speaking with these, we might not put it on net, because there's other things that we're not going to put on the net there. So you won't hear about this, so you'll have to listen to this explanation. So that they were in control of the Chinese government, and they believed themselves to be the most powerful people on earth as a result of that. I asked one lady celestial spirit to come to them, and they, 5 million of these women, could not harm her. 5 million couldn't harm one person. That's how much power they had. And then I asked the lady to display some of her powers to them, which really shocked them. And eventually they got into a lot of grief as a result of seeing the contrast between their power and the power that this one single spirit had. Now, this group of women that I was speaking with, they view men as like superfluous to society, basically. And so I asked one man to come, who was a celestial spirit as well. And what could they do to the one man? Nothing. And you know the difference is? The difference was the amount of love. Not the amount of rage, anger, terror, any of those other emotions. The difference was the amount of love. You see, we have this viewpoint on Earth, and this is one of our problems with the world's definition of love. We have this viewpoint on Earth that love is a weak emotion. You think about it in your own relationships even. If you are openly and unabashedly in love with your partner, you'll see how many of your same sex feels that to be a place of weakness. There's even words for it, which I won't repeat, in our language in Australia, for that. When we have a feeling of love towards our partner, you know, there's these words that are used, often quite derogatory, saying how controlled we are by our love. Love doesn't control anything and can't be controlled. So it's another false belief we have about love, that love results in control. Can you see? So we need to stop seeing the world's definition of what is powerful. That's the point I'm trying to get at here. We need to stop seeing terror, fear, anger, rage as power and start seeing them for what they really are emotionally. They are the weakest possible emotions we could engage in. They are also the most damaging to our soul. Every time we engage in them, we reinforce the damage to our own soul. So they are the worst possible emotions that we could engage inside of ourselves. Now, I'm not saying to not experience them. I'm saying we need to stop going to them as our power play, as our way of feeling better about what's going on inside of ourselves emotionally. Yeah? So the world's definition of love is that love is weak. What's God's definition of love? It is the greatest and most powerful emotion that you will ever and could ever experience. Can you see the difference between those two totally opposite opinions? One is saying love is weak, vulnerable, you know, and all those kind of things. Love isn't vulnerable, I don't believe, at all. Can you see how many of us feel that love is vulnerable? It's not vulnerable. Love, you know everything that's going on around you. How is that a position of vulnerability? Isn't it a position of strength? Love is the strongest possible thing you could experience in every situation. That's the truth. That's God's truth. Unfortunately, the way the world sees it is that love is one of the weakest and easily manipulated emotions on the planet. That's the way the world sees it. Totally incorrect. I put to you that if love is manipulated, then it's not love, because love cannot be manipulated. That's the reality. So the world's definition of love is the complete opposite to God's definition of love. And the world's definition of fear, anger, terror, rage, those kind of emotions, is in the place of God's definition of love. We view this as the most powerful position, unfortunately, most of the time. Mary?
I feel No.
Is this a question?
No, yeah, I'm an audience member now.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm not teaching.
Yeah, good.
I wanted to try and share a little bit about my experience of what you were just talking about.
But would an audience member do that? And would I let an audience member do that?
No. Okay, that's all right. I'll leave it.
What are you going to say? Sorry. You can come up here and share it, darling.
No, I don't.
It's worth sharing what you've got to say about the process you've been through over the last 3 or 4 months.
Yeah, because I really feel I've been walking this not as an intellectual process.
Yeah.
And this, it's been really strong within me that, like, I've really been praying a lot for God to show me that love is the most powerful force in our, the defining, controlling force in our universe.
Mm.
Because of the level of terror that I carry, I look around in the world that we live in and I say, no, fear rules here, mm. anger rules here.
Mm.
And so I love these words that you're talking about,
mm.
But I know in my honesty, if I'm in truth, my truth as I am right now, I'm still praying a lot to receive this truth in yeah. my soul
yeah.
that... love rules because I do glimpse at times that love does rule this world because there is always a consequence for the fear and the mm. harm and the anger and all of that.
Yeah.
It's just harder to see it here. If we feel our souls, then I feel it immediately. Whenever mm. I'm in fear or anger or shame or and I live in that place, I feel the penalty on my soul now more.
And the weakness of it as well.
Yes, mm. but once upon a time I could detune from all of that and I thought it was a pretty, you know...
Powerful
way to live, to avoid fear and
yeah.
to use control to get what I want.
Yeah.
So I just... I have a lot of feeling at the moment because it's really what I'm walking through as in a causal way, I feel, about really accepting that love does rule everything.
Yeah.
But
this is why it's so hard, isn't it, living in the world? Because fear rules the world and we've grown up in the world, then we're going to grow up in a condition where fear rules us. That's the reality, unfortunately. But when we're confronted with this concept, even as a beginning, it's an intellectual concept, that actually, no, God created a universe that love rules, now we're starting to be quite confused, aren't we? Because the world we see around us, fear rules, and what we're trying to present is that, no, actually, in the entire universe, God's love rules. And we're starting to go, well, no, that's not my reality. That's not what I'm seeing. Because what I see is that fear rules here.
And I've literally felt huge emotional distress at this truth. Like, mm. I feel like it's less now, but really, you know, it has been so... It's like an assault on my reality
mm.
to accept that love rules because of... And this is... This, I guess, is sort of my question, is about we need to release our terror, don't we, in order to accept this?
Yes. Terror is the emotion that prevents the truth that love rules from entering our own soul. So here's our soul here. And the thing that prevents this truth from entering me is the emotion of terror and fear.
And really, like, I have... It's so confronting to... It's so beautiful to hear you speak about these things. I love it. It's like, you know, a balm on your soul and you go, yes, this is the truth.
Yeah.
But to live this, to confront my terror in my daily life... And to have faith that no, love rules this process with me.
Yes.
That is tumultuous.
Yep.
And that's, I guess, what I wanted to
And this
share.
Is the importance, isn't it, of those two qualities, faith and courage.
And yes.
Because what I'm saying to you is that love does rule the universe, but before you're going to ever experience your terror fully, you're going to have faith that that's true. You're going to have faith that there is a God who loves, and God created this system that is loving in the universe, and these two qualities are going to be able to drive you into experiencing these terrors that you experience. And as Mary correctly pointed out, if you don't experience your terror and your fear, you will never, ever emotionally accept that love rules. You'll never emotionally accept it in your entire life. Right? And I've talked to many spirits who have lived thousands of years who have yet to accept that love actually rules the universe. And because of that, that truth hasn't entered their heart, and it's always because of the level of terror and fear they are in personally that they don't release. Yeah? Yep. Justin? And then up to back to Liam.
Just with this feeling of love, working through a bit of stuff with the boys lately, I'll work through some little addictions, and it'll be like the situations will change in how I behave, how they behave, and that sort of thing, which has been really good.
Yeah.
But it's like the interactions now are I know I'm being more loving to them. But it's like I feel very lost, without that, it's sort of without the addiction going. Now that that's gone, it's like
you're getting stripped of the veneer.
Yeah, and I feel really, it's almost a little bit frightening. I feel lost. It's like, well, I don't know what this is.
Yeah, and this is a good place to stay in. You'll get used to it. Remember, in many of the talks in the past, I've talked about the soul expanding, being stretched. Remember I've talked about that? You see, we're trying often to prevent the stretching of our own soul, right? The way it stretches is by going through these positions of confusion and these feelings of feeling like I don't know where I am now. This is a good sign that your soul is stretching to a new place. Do you get that?
Yeah, I get it. It just feels,
because if you're in a level of comfort, what's happening? Nothing's stretching, nothing's changing, but you're going to feel comfortable, of course, but nothing's stretching, nothing's changing. And this is another false belief that the world has about love. They feel love is constant, you know? If they love me, they'll love me for the rest of their life, you know? If it's really love, that's... And they have this feeling of that it generates loyalty. In other words, if somebody says they love me, then they should be loyal to me and so forth. They have all these feelings, right? But the reality is that love constantly changes. It causes change.
I think I had this expectation of what love would feel like.
Uh-huh.
And it's not that.
No, but can you see, because our expectation of what love feels like has nothing to do with God's love. It's got everything to do with the world's definition of love. Because we grew up in a world expecting those things. That's the thing. So every single time we're going to think that it's this and even want to feel that it's the world's definition, but it's going to be very, very different than the world's definition every single time. Very different. Yeah. Can we go back up to Liam with the mic?
With you saying before that love was invulnerable, don't we ourselves have to be vulnerable to receive it?
I don't feel we have to be vulnerable at all, no. That's my feeling.
Or as in, be vulnerable enough to drop your fear of accepting what love could be, rather than accepting what you feel love is.
Yeah, myself and Mary have had many discussions about this word vulnerability, hey. And I just cannot agree that vulnerability is actually about being open to receiving love. I feel the reality is that vulnerability is a product of your fear. In other words, every time you think I'm being vulnerable, you're actually in a state of fear and covering over with it by justifying a word called vulnerability. Do you understand what I'm saying there? I know that might sound a bit confusing. When I believe I'm being vulnerable, I am automatically in a state of fear. When I'm in a state of being open to love completely, I no longer feel that I'm vulnerable. I feel strong. I feel completely a different emotion. I don't feel vulnerable at all. I feel strength when I'm totally open to love. And this is where I feel the word vulnerability comes from, an underlying fear of being open and truthful. And it's a fear actually of being attacked, I feel, that causes us to use this word vulnerability. Yeah. My feelings are that when I am truly open to love and love is flowing through me, I no longer feel invulnerable, I feel impregnable. I feel completely the opposite once I'm in a state of love. This is why God has the most impregnable position in the universe, because God has the most love. And that's the beauty of love. You see, it's our viewpoint again that gets, I feel twisted by these words and twisted in the end by the feeling of fear. So I often hear many of you use the word, I'm being vulnerable now. Whereas I would say back to you, and I've said this to Mary frequently, no, you're being fearful now. The fact that you're now saying to me that you're being vulnerable is a fear being expressed. Because you wouldn't feel that way if you were truly open and felt a position of strength in the love that you and truth that you're expressing. Does that make sense there? Yeah. Completely different way that most people, I feel about these emotions.
It's probably because, as I said, love that people receive ends up hurting them in some way.
Yes.
Therefore, they fear receiving it.
And I put to you that love that hurts wasn't love in the first place. And we'll talk about, we'll revise some of the discussion that we had in a minute, in the previous one. Jen, thanks. What's my time? 10:53.
Does love bring awareness?
Love brings everything. Love brings knowledge, awareness, understanding, truth, passion, desire. Everything that's good that you can imagine in the universe comes through the vehicle of love. So, I just find, this is where I feel that the reason why I'm doing this series of discussions with the audience, Jen, is because I feel we're still taking on the world's view of love. And what is the world's view of love? It's like those things that we listed earlier, you know, that love is weak, right? Love is powerless. Love is vulnerable. And we could make a long list, could we not, of all of these things that the world views love to be, and yet when we look at them, God is not weak. God is not powerless. The pinnacle of love in the universe is not weak. The pinnacle of love in the universe, God, is not powerless. And God's position is not vulnerable. It's impregnable. So can you see, it's like, what are we thinking here? We're thinking the wrong way, aren't we? By thinking that love is these things, we're actually just taking on the world's definition of it all. That's all we're doing, isn't it? We're not really taking on God's definition, because God's definition, if you look at God and the position God's in, God's definition is totally the opposite of what we're thinking. Yeah? Does that make sense, Jen?
Yes, thank you.
Yep.
Also, I would like to ask, it feels more childlike for me, this place to love.
I agree.
And more spontaneous and...
See, now you're listing some other emotions, which I don't agree are in the weak, powerless and vulnerable place. I don't feel the feeling of being a child is weak. And I don't feel spontaneous. Is that how you spell it? Is weak. but the world does. You see, can you see how we got it all? The world's viewing all these things. And it's no wonder we've grown up thinking all of these things, because the world around us views it all this way. So we grow up thinking exactly the way the world thinks, right? That's what we do. But the reality is, a lot of the words that are used, we think, no, being a child's not weak. Like, man, the child's freedom is incredible compared to my own. If you think about it, how much our life is dictated to compared to a child's, right? If a child has freedom and is spontaneous. And the word spontaneous, isn't it lovely to live in a spontaneous world? Now, for many of us, we go, no, it's not lovely, because we want control. And we feel control is powerful, right? No, no. Control is over here in reality. Control is one of the weakest things that we could do. When we deal with the cause of control and we no longer have it in our lives, we will love an uncontrolled life. The irony is, it's going to be far better than your controlled one. That's also one of the realities of truth of God's love, huh? So can you see through this discussion already that we have grown up in this environment that accepts that the world's definition of love is the truth about love? And the reality, unfortunately, is entirely flip-sided to that, entirely the opposite. The world's definition of love is so far away from love to be laughable, really. And it's certainly not logical either. And God's position of love, which, by the way, the world views as weak, powerless, vulnerable, and all those other things, is actually the strongest position that anybody could ever have. And this is why I like, just before a break, I'd like to... I'm sorry, I'm going to pull out the Bible now for all of you people who are upset. I just got a different one. I'm in the process of buying different translations of the Bible. And you know, there's some things that it says that are quite good, right? Tomorrow in our discussion, we'll also see that there's some things that it says that are not very good at all, unfortunately. But there are some things that it says that are good. And my dear friend John penned this with some spirit inspiration. It says, God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in him. In this way, love is made complete among us so that we may have confidence on the day of judgment, because in this world we are like him. There is no fear in love, but perfect love drives out fear, because fear has to do with punishment. The one who fears is not made perfect in love. It's a lovely verse, don't you think? It's in 1 John 4, starts in verse 16 to 18. And that's what we're trying to do, is try to illustrate to you the difference between the world's viewpoint of love. See, the world doesn't have that viewpoint of love, unfortunately. The world has a very, very different viewpoint of love. And what we need to do is we need to start within ourselves challenging this viewpoint that we have accepted all of our lives. Many times until this point, we've accepted this all of our lives, that the world's viewpoint of love is the only correct viewpoint of love. And we have denied in our soul, because of the terror and fear that exists within our soul, we deny this one major truth that's going to come from God when we allow ourselves to feel our terror and our fear. And that is this truth that actually God's love rules the universe. Love is actually the most powerful emotion that we could ever feel. That's the reality. Can you see that before this reality, before this truth can enter me, I must be prepared to actually experience my terror and my fear. Without experiencing my terror and my fear, this truth cannot enter me, and I am going to believe this truth to be false. I am going to believe this to be true, that fear rules the universe. And you know, when I believe intellectually and more importantly, emotionally, that fear rules the universe, you know what I've just done? I have made myself subservient to fear. Fear has become my owner, and I have become its slave. That's what I've done. But once I can accept this, and the only way I'm going to accept this, remember, is to remove these feelings from within me. Once I can accept this, from that moment on, I am now believing that love rules the universe. And what becomes my owner? Love also becomes my owner. It's love that dictates my actions then. Can you see the importance of dealing with your fears and terror? You remember sort of about a year ago or so now, and some of these DVDs will be coming out over the coming few months once we've put them in production, that I did a series of talks about fear. Can you see why I did? It's because without you experiencing this terror and fear with inside of yourself and actually releasing it so that it's no longer a part of you, you will never accept God's definition of love. You will always have the world's definition of it. And while you have the world's definition of it, it's impossible to act in a loving way without trying. And this is where why many of you feel tired. Because you're having to try to get over the terror and fear that exists within you that is telling you that this is true, the fear rules, rather than telling you that this is true, that love rules. And that's a very important step to make in your own spiritual progression. One of the most important steps you can ever make, actually.